We will now have the Søren Straarup talk about an arm from shoulder to hand, and please go on, Søren.
Okay, well, I got a new job where I work with embedded systems, and yeah, long story short, I was working on FreeBSD before I started this job, and then I wanted to bring it into the job. So I've gotten the opportunity to use company hardware to develop FreeBSD stuff on, even though I work in other platforms at job. What the ARM philosophy is actually that it should be a core of some kind, and then you modulize everything, all the peripherals around it, to match exactly what you want. So you don't have a standard component, you have many different, which we also can see today that there's Atmel and Intel and I think it's Marvel now, which has all kinds of ARM processors in both speed and power usage.
Instruments.
Huh?
Texas Instruments as well.
Yeah, there's many of them. And yeah, the basic idea was that it should be a RISC machine, reduced instruction set. And it should be modular. And then we have the most important one, I think, is that it should be able, you should be able to build it on old hardware fabrics, with all old fabrication methods, which will mean that many can come in on it. And those that are still active of generations I know of is from 7 and ARM 9 and up. I can't remember if it's 10 or 11 that's the highest now. But primarily work with ARM 9. Well, there's a lot of things that you actually have to think about to get your device under test to boot. You have the processor, which is one ARM core, and that's well known. And then you have the RAM and other external things, or storage, data storage of some kind. One thing I was quite astonished about the Atmel AT9200 is that it has an internal bootloader, which you can actually hardwire to receive a bootloader via xmodem or its serial debug port. Does say that you don't have to have JTAG equipment to develop the bootloader. It's simply connected with the serial cable and you're going. But in Atmel's case, there are quite some different things. In their 9200 model, there's about 12 kilobyte of internal memory, and the current bootloader, which we use, the boot IIC, is about 9 kilobyte big. But for the next generation, which is the 9260, it only has 4 kilobyte internal RAM, where this one has 12. So it has to, everyone is complaining about getting FreeBSD to run that one, since the whole boot system has to be rewritten. And then there's the abstraction layers to get in contact with everything. Everything is, yeah, more or less bus orientated. We have SPI, IIC, and you have different memory buses. And yeah, there's many, many versions of it all, of the ARM family. In the Atmel one, the smaller ones, it doesn't have any internal display drivers, which, yeah, in most cases you don't need it anyway. If you want to do some simple electronic to control, and it's back to basics. It's when I play with it, I compare it very much to play with the peak processors. It's all the way down. And one of the reasons why we have to have abstraction layers is that the physical interface for the network card is not connected directly to the Mac, so you can pick your own. But the Mac unit is in this processor on board, or on chip. And yeah. And I see the trend in other open source that they are trying to split up what we in old days called a network interface card into what it actually consists of, the Mac peripheral and the physical converter. And that's one of the things I think you should do. Yeah, this one was malplaced, but to play with it, you need a source tree. And then you, more or less, after you do that, you do the initial changes to get your board supported, which is one of the first I figured out is that you have in the conf options arm, you can set board specific variables that you then can use in your kernel configuration. But they have to be declared there. And then for Atmel board, for boot, you have a special boot directory which contains multiple bootloaders depending on what data flash or bus architecture you want to pull in your data via. There's IIC and SPI. The makefile, it has hard-coded for now that it uses a KB920X board per default in source. Of course, that has to be either specified on the command line or changed in the makefile in ink file. And then you can, for now, there's also in the lib 1891, there's hard-coded to make the boot process a little bit faster. So you only have to load the loader and then it does the rest for you. It then set up to pick up TFTP, the kernel, and execute it. What you basically do is you discard the space there and there. There's no spaces. But you make up your build environment, and that line is missing, but it had to be another line down here that said cross tools, a tool chain it is. After that, you just go into the bootloader and make it. What I then use to upload it with is Minicom, but it's only reason I use it is that it supports xmodem. There isn't much other. Yeah, there's the bare executable, but I haven't looked into how to use it. Yeah. And here we go again with how to build their bootloader. But basically, you have to do the build environment and then the tool chain, and then you can go down to the boot directory, make it, and then you can actually go back up to source and build your userland, a build world, and install world on another destination, and then NFS mounted. So the process is pretty straightforward, and for my case, it's been so much simple to get the initial stage up and running because Warner Losh has done tremendous work with the ARM processors, and there's quite a few others that have put in a lot of effort to get the especially the ARM Atmel up and running. To get the just to get it built and get the loader uploaded to the device was somewhat easy. There was a lot of beginning problem with the physical interface. Later on, I discovered that there is some inconsistency between the other boards that are supported by FreeBSD and the one I'm working on. I haven't gotten into where it actually goes wrong, but it's in the random device. Something doesn't get set up right there, and I suspect it's just an addressing problem. And my next step is then to get something like RTC, data flash, working also where I can actually boot from the device standalone. But it takes a lot of hours to do that. But there's a lot of good work put into it. The most of it is getting the addressing right on the individual board. So, things I've thought about, which I see on other operating systems, is that they have wear leveling for NAND flash, for example. That's one thing I haven't figured out yet that there's anybody that has implemented in FreeBSD. And I thought about maybe it would be possible to do it in GEOM, and GEOM geometric layer, so you have it abstracted from the disk driver and the FS. And the second thing, since the ARM port of FreeBSD is so new, there's a lot of tinkling in together where you don't really have the board separated, but you hard code into the code the board specific data, and then you compile it, and when you update, well, then you get someone else's hard coded stuff. And that's something that might be interesting to look at, how to extract that out of there so you actually have it more say that this board has these files that it includes in some places. And that's something I would probably look at again to see whether you can pull it out and make it more uniform to say you can copy one thing and then correct the addressings and device configurations, device options, and then you go. Because it's not that simple today. It's a lot of may the source be with you at the moment. But it's quite fun to figure out where stuff goes wrong. You learn to use the kernel debugger. So, but yeah. For now, I've gotten so far that I can get it up to where it mounts the root file system. I haven't gotten up to where it actually mounts it yet. But it comes up and complains that it can't find it. But there's one thing that I'm trying to drive at the work I'm at now is that it's under BSDL. Which, in my point of view, is a little bit more suited for commercial products, since you don't have to share the code. But that's a whole new way to go, and new argument. But that's one of the things I'm working on in my spare time to get it into so we can slowly move it into the company and see if it actually catches on. And for those that are interested, we could use some more input on their ARM at freebsd.org list. It's kind of quiet once in a while, but there's some very knowledgeable people around there. So, but there's not that many, what do you call it, already running projects, pieces of electronic. It's mostly development boards that are supported at the moment. Of, I think there's like 5 or 6 different development boards that are supported. So.
Do you know if there's any support for other boards on the way?
Not that I kind of know of. We need more people into the group to say, I take this up with a drone, look at it.
Because almost all of the smartphones, they are based on ARM.
Yeah.
I've been working on V-scale CPUs in Air Force, and lack of time and too much Linux is making it slow progress.
Yeah, X-scale is also, that's more the high end in my classification of the ARM process due to its speed, where this one I'm working with from Atmel, it runs a little bit lower than 200 megahertz. The X-scale, wasn't it going from 6 and up, or is it 4 and up, 400 megahertz and up to a gigahertz or so. So it's, but it also has the display driver, as far as I remember. But I haven't had the chance to play with that one yet. Yeah?
Do you have anybody working on the open local
phone in
Magic?
No, but it's on my wish list.
Are you going to buy one?
At some point I'm. They're new, but when the version.
The second version should be out here in October.
Yeah.
December.
I thought about buying that one just to look at it. Cool toy. Yeah.
Is there any plans to add support for more Ferriprions found on the ARM9200 board, for example, USB device support?
There's people that claim that they have USB up and running. It's at least found. So. The driver finds the host side. I'm not sure how well the client side will work. So, but there's, as far as I know, there's support for IRC, SPI, and USB, and a couple and a regular UART on the 9200. So. But there's a steady development going on, and you can follow the code. There's the pairs, because I think there's about a handful of people that actually working on it at the moment and coming with input. But it's, yeah, I kind of just start a new job. Woo, nice hardware. I have to try this. And that's where I start. And I've never touched the kernel in that way before. Neither the L kernel or the FreeBSD kernel. So, that was a giant leap to throw yourself up in kernel code, but it's quite amazing. But there's no one to watch out for you. If you make mistakes, you make them. And you learn to live with them and correct them. So, that's where the raw power is. The fun area, one of the fun areas. Yeah?
I read the bare level name on your wish list here. I also have the impression that nowadays, well, flash hardware has a kind of built in. You don't need to do that anymore.
No.
These sticks and compact cards and so on, yes. Yeah. But if you just buy a NAND, embedded devices, you just have the NAND chip
connected. And it's so cheap that you can only have the memory. You have no controller with it. And I think isn't it a compact flash that comes as a card that actually has it built in, but where the SD card doesn't, as far as I remember?
Compact flash has it built in.
Yeah, and SD doesn't.
I don't know about that.
I don't think it has. So. that's one of the things I would love to see, is the well leveling.
I'm talking about porting
JFS2
or something similar to FreeBSD.
I would probably go with something similar, not to get into the license talks. Yeah.
Asked the question about flash files.
Ah, yeah, that's that what. Yeah, down there.
I've been discussing the NAND flash support issue with David Young.
Yeah.
The room would like to discuss
that further. I can tell you what we've come up with and came up with. Okay. And everyone knows it's an issue. Yeah. So I still have time, I can tell, I can see. So I don't know. Anything else you would like to hear about it? It's nice because you have this device we are currently using is like 64 megabyte RAM, and the version I have is 16 megabyte of flash, and it uses about a little less than a watt running at 180 or 178 megahertz. That's though with the operating system. But I hope that I get it up and fully running soon, and actually can offer to customers so they have an alternative. Because I hear often that they choose not to use the other operating system due to licenses. And I think that would probably gain BSD with its license.
When you're thinking about licensing problems, I assume you're talking about GPL.
Yeah.
How do you feel about
GPL-3? I
want to
start.
Okay, let's not go there.
But it's the whole philosophy behind it that it's.
But do you know where the FreeBSD product is headed? I mean, are we going to start forks or?
No.
There is no consensus yet.
No. There's nothing said about it.
So. But GCC is basically GCC is the biggest hurdle to get data in GPL code. And GCC is no longer the only game in town. It used to be for many, many years there was no alternative, but there are at least two alternatives now, at least on some platforms. You have Tendrion and the LLVM. And the LLVM is probably the most interesting.
Okay. Earth, yeah. That's often discussed, and it goes into the forest when you talk licenses. But that's, yeah, what the open source is about. Yeah. Anybody else?
Gift.
Thank you. Yeah. Another time?
Yeah. And the next one will start at 3 o'clock. So there's a longer break. I have a short message from Riley. This is short. Some of the books, a few of the books are already sold out, but they will ship it at only £5 cost, so you can still have them.
It's not good.
Why?
It's a clone of Intel, it's not ARM.
No, it's not ARM, no.
But it's embedded.
Yeah, that's the joy of it.